Greetings yet again to each and all, those who still care and dare to listen, and a wicked welcome to Mythophrenia, where you find talks and texts by Gnostic teacher John Lamlash on a range of topics relevant to the Terma of Gaia Awakening, the Sophianic view of life, Planetary Tantra, and the Calico War Party. Recording on January 19th, 2017. This is a spoken commentary to accompany the written text on The Great Deception, Part 3. And the subtitle here is Love and the Supernatural. As I've said before, on at least one occasion, if I recall correctly, I don't apologize for being myself. It's just a rule that I have. I do set a very high standard. I don't like to use the word very. Let's just say I set a high standard for the exposition of the material I present, if I might speak in such a grandiose manner, a high standard of delivery. And right now, I would advise you that I may not be coming across at my usual level. But I'm coming across nonetheless. So here I am, and here we go. The third installment of the three-part material on the Great Deception in Mythophrenia has been on my mind a lot since I completed the first two parts, and it's taken me rather longer than I had wished to come to the conclusion with this important topic. I ask you out there who are listening to my recorded words right now, whether you be longtime followers of my work and familiar with me and my style and syntax and themes and topics, or whether you be just getting on to my message, or whether you be a total newcomer, I ask you to consider that I do work under a considerable handicap. Take, for instance, this material, these two blocks of material. If you look at Mythophrenia right now on metahistory.org, you'll see that there's a block of material that I've constructed since I came back to public speaking in October of 2016. And that block consists of 10 components. Three of the components are the talks on the true Lucifer is Sophia. And three of those components are the talks on the Great Deception. And then there are four other talks, including Director's Cut and the introduction to the Maitreya process. Okay? 10 components to the foundation of Mythophrenia, which is also the foundation, you could say, of whatever future teaching process I intend to present. Well, let's just take those two units of three each. If I were a professor of comparative mythology, history of religion, psychology and metapsychology, comparative literature, entheogenics, if I were a professor or any of those professors of those genres, or maybe all of them wrapped into one, and I had a university and an auditorium in which to deliver my lectures, then I would do it like this. I would invite the students to come to a six-week course. It's 3 2-hour classes, three times a week, for 6 weeks, Okay? And in that setting, in an auditorium, with an hour or a little more to deliver the lecture, as professors do, and with another hour for open discussion and debate, and for the elaboration of certain points within the lecture, given the benefit of immediate feedback from the students in the audience, then I could develop this material for you in a wonderful, rich, vibrant manner. But you see, I can't do that because I do not have a university and I do not have an auditorium for 500 or 1,000 students. And I've spoken to 1,000 people in the past and really enjoyed it and got the vibe, and they got my vibe. Well, that vibe can't work through cyberspace. So this is not interactive. I don't have the auditorium, and I don't have the time, frankly. Even if I did have those facilities at my disposal and a number of letters after my name, and it's about time for that, some people think. Even if I had all that, honestly, my friends, I don't have time to give 2 6-week courses on this material. And yet this is imperatively crucial material for the orientation to the Sophianic way of life and to the Gnostic message in the way that I develop it and deliver it. So I am acutely aware of operating under this handicap, and I ask you likewise to be aware. And thank you. Now, I think what I might say to begin, it just slides into my mind in this way right now, after having made that little prefatory remark. I think to begin, I might say that there's a super learning process underway on this planet. That's right, there is. I announced, I believe, in the talk on the Maitreya process, or somewhere in this 10 talks of the foundation of mythophrenia, I announced a time period of 11 months from October 2016 to November 2017. Let me clarify. It's during those 11 months that the super learning process gets installed. So I'm using the term installation as an analogy to a technical installation. There's a technical installation taking place in your mind. And my voice is just a surrogate circuit within that installation. My voice. My voice is a surrogate for a function in your mind. And this super learning process, once installed, I can't even tell you, and I'm the head technician, in a sense, of the installation. I can't even tell you what will come of it, or what those human animals who realize, who engage the super learning process, will be able to do with it, because it is beyond any reckoning and beyond anything that's ever been achieved by the human race before. And you can count on that. You can count on it. Now, I have to say that I am wondering if you got the joke yet, because I'm putting one over on you here in a sense. I'm telling you, first of all, that I am a Gnostic technician who is assisting the Aeon Sophia in the technical installation of a super learning process in the mind of the human species, right? Anyone else on the internet claiming to do that, by the way? And and your master technician cannot even calculate that there are 13 months from October 2016 to November 2017. Right? Right? If this doesn't get a laugh out of you, I don't know what will. But you know, for you, it's 13 months. But for me, it's only 11. From November to October. That's what it is for the technician. So I tend to speak of what it is for me. But in the future, just to be literal-minded about it, I'll refer to the super learning installation event as taking place in 13 months. All right. So imagine that you're having cable installed, right? Sophia had cable installed. Oh, yes, she did. And I've described that cable in great detail. I've described the three braids of that seven-stranded cable, which is wound through the spindle of the Pleiades from the galactic core to the Earth and constitutes the mechanism of pleromic relay. If you ever have the occasion to go back and listen to the Gaian Navigation Experiment talks, which are now being transcribed to be printed in a set of 10 logbooks running to over 3,000 pages. If you ever get occasion to go back into those logs and listen to the navigator briefings, you will see how I took the crew and passengers along with me on a journey with a mothership. And in the process of that journey, we made together some astonishing discoveries. And one of those discoveries was the installation of pleromic relay and the consequent appearance in the sky of a new constellation. The constellation of the celestial anchor appeared in the sky in September of 2012. When pleromic relay was completed. So the Aeon Sophia, which is a fancy way of speaking of the planetary logos, or the mind of the planet, had an installation into the electromagnetic, the bioelectromagnetic aura of the planet, the bioelectromagnetic aura, called the BEMA, B-E-M-A. She had an installation, and through that installation, the Aeon Sophia is now capable of being in direct and immediate contact with the galactic center from which she originates. Now, with that as a kind of backstory, you can perhaps approach the notion that there is another kind of installation taking place within the atmosphere of the Earth. And this installation is a really, really, really novel and spectacular event. Back in the year 2016, or before the year 2016, actually, I had announced, based on Gnostic intel, and based on the method of Gnostic investigation, which is clear and transparent to everyone, I'm not channeling, I'm not doing anything behind your back, I'm not doing any mumbo-jumbo transactions with discarnate entities. I am a totally incarnate, living Gnostic teacher, telling you what I do, teaching you how to do what I do. And from that basis, I announced that January to August of 2016 was going to be the sovereign moment. Well, glory be. You know, when I announced that, I didn't even know what I was talking about. But this often works out this way in the Gnostic education process, if you want to call it that. The higher education of the human race, of which the Romantics dreamed and for which they hoped, but for which they had no adequate foundation, is now actualized here and now in what I teach you. The higher education of the human race. And a spectacular moment has come in the higher education of the human race. The Aeonic Mother has agency. Now, I don't know if you're listening to me for the first time. This could be the first time you ever heard my voice. Or you could be someone who's picking up on my talks here and there, delving into metahistory, diving for treasure. Or you could be a long-time and loyal follower, of which I have quite a few, and I love them deeply. And we are all integral in our love for the planetary animal mother and her story. You could be in any of those three categories. But let me assure you that when John Lash says, the Aeonic Mother has agency, that is a statement to change the world. That is a statement to transform humanity's knowledge of itself and to transform and transfigure and advance and enhance the very actions you take every day of your life to show that you are truly human. You can only be known to another human animal as being human. You can only be known among yourselves as human animals as having the sense of humanity by the way you prove it in your actions at every moment, in your actions, in your perceptions, and in the very way you look out of your eyes. Not only to the natural world around you, but to all of the non-human world, and then selectively into the human world. Not every human animal living on this planet carries the sense of humanity. In fact, a minority do. And there is an increase due to this problem. Okay, which the Gnostics have outlined in great detail, namely, the problem with the divine experiment on Earth due to the intrusion of the Archons, the machinations of their proxies, the Jews, and a number of other serious disturbances in the divine design of this planet. Due to all that, well, there are some people that lack the sense of humanity and have even lost their humanity. Yeah, that's a fact. And there are people, there are human animals walking around on this planet, a great many of them in positions of power and influence in the social order, banking, law, the military, the media, who are really no longer human. They are what you can call archontified humans, or archontic hybrids, as it were. Although they have, presumably, let's give them the benefit of the doubt, okay? Although they have, presumably, the genetic makeup of a human animal, and bear in mind the Gnostics taught that the Archons could not hack into the human genome, and I stand by that. Even given that they have the genetic makeup of a human animal, there are increasing numbers of your fellow humans who are archontic hybrids. They are not human. Now, this super learning experience has very rigorous standards of entrance. You know, there's an entrance exam for this, which I'm going to be giving very soon. Huh? There's an entrance exam for the super learning experience. And these three talks on the great deception, as inadequate and fallible as they may be, at least form a prop. They form a kind of scaffolding for the entrance exam and for what's to come next. What's coming next? Huh? You wonder what's coming next? You do well to wonder what's coming next. Now, to return to the analogy of having cable installed at your house, okay? I'm presenting this as an analogy to the super learning event. It's better to call it an event. You know, go tell somebody, hey, did you know? Did you hear about this? There's a super learning event happening right now. Okay? And you can compare it to the cable company coming in to your house and not just installing a cable, a line, an ADSL line, but installing a really complicated system that allows you to make the maximum use of your goddess-given faculties and what is called, in Gnostic terms, your endowment. So the installation is from a company. The company controls the franchise. The company provides all the equipment. The company brings the cable to your body. It brings the cable to your body, okay? And the owner of the company and the producer of all the equipment and the one who supplies the cable is none other than the planetary animal mother, the true Lucifer, Sophia, the Aeon Sophia, the world mother, the wisdom goddess. And I'm like the technician that comes to your house and installs it. Well, how do I do that? Well, I just use my voice, because my voice is a surrogate circuit in your mind. It's not just a voice. It's not just another voice. It's the one and only voice that can install the super learning event in your mind and in your life. To be precise, the super learning event is installed in your body mind. It's installed in your entire psychosomatic mental emotive system, in the totality of what you are as an animal. And my role is to shift an analogy from electronics, cable installation, to the field of IT. Okay, no problem. I can use an archontic or IT analogy to describe a process of this living Sophianic intelligence. And why can I do that? Because I am an instrument of that intelligence and I know exactly what I'm talking about. So I can use any language I want. I can use any metaphor I want to convey to you what is happening to you should you choose to accept it. And if you are disposed to accept it, and if you are qualified to accept it, depending on your GQ level. GQ, your Gnostic quotient. It's sort of like the IQ squared. No, the IQ to the power of 10 is the GQ. So if you are qualified for this installation, then I can assure you with great delight that this installation is now underway. And I said I was going to make an archonic analogy. You know how when you download an app into your computer, and sometimes the company that is offering you that app gives you the guidance. It says, follow these steps. So you follow a number of dialog boxes on the screen, right? It says, here, follow these steps and we'll guide you through the installation. Well, that's what I'm doing. You get it? That's all you have to know. If you get that, you're on. If you don't get that, then don't bother to listen to me anymore, honestly. Because I don't count on quantity. I count on the attention of the level that is equivalent to what I deliver. I deal from the top of the deck. So, the hottest intel on this planet right now is the Gnostic intel coming out of the sovereign moment. The Aeonic Mother has agency. And if I were to elaborate that statement to you, if I were to go into the technical aspects of it just a little bit further, would you like me to do that? Well, here goes. During the sovereign moment of 2016, the Aeon Sophia hacked into the human mind in a way that has never occurred ever before in any period of human history or any cycle of the earth. She hacked into the first attention and into the second attention by using the third attention. Technically, that's how she did it. Now, the teaching of the first, second, and third attention belong to the guidance that I provide to you during the installation process. Can you see that? So the teaching about the first, second, and third attention, which is high expertise of Gnostic shamanic intel, is now yours for the learning. It's yours to learn. Do you really mean to learn? Do you really want to know? It's yours to learn now. What are the three attentions and how they operate? So I can make the statement to you off the top of the head, because as a Gnostic shaman, as a telestes, I have ascertained this information. I have acquired this knowledge by gnosis, by direct experiential engagement with the intelligence of the earth. So I can say the Aeon Sophia has used her power, the power of her third attention, which is deeply mysterious, that is called the mirroring attention, to hack into and acquire access to the first attention of the human animal, and at the same time to make certain specific and intentional modifications in the second attention, which show up in the bifunctionality of the memory circuit, which appears to be a very mysterious anomaly to many people. Well, what is the bifunctionality of the memory circuit of the human animal? Well, look around. There's a rumor going around that some people remember certain events and certain details of human life, you know, sometimes very trivial details. Some people remember these details in one way, and others remember them in a completely different manner. Well, gee whiz, Mr. Wizard. How did that happen? So, from the viewpoint of a telestis, the way it happens is clear. The Aeon Sophia has access to the second attention of the human animal. Memory is a sub-function of the second attention, and she is doing something in human memory. So the superlearning process consists, you could say, of two parts, just parallel or similar to what happens when you download an app. The first part is that you have to install it, and in the process of installation, I teach you how to use it. And then when the installation is over, you use it. You use it as your own power. And that is the power of genius that I confer upon you as the technician overseeing this process. Now, why are these 10 talks in Metaphrenia so important as a kind of gateway to this super learning event? Well, there's a lot of error in the human mind, and there's a lot of clutter in your mind as regards the concepts of the satanic, the luciferic, the demonic, and the supernatural. And it's just as if I came with my little delivery truck, I drive up to the front of your house, you know, I'm the Sophianic intelligence technician, and I've got all my gear, and I've got my belt on with my tools, and I come into your house, and I say, okay, where do you want me to install this super learning event? And you show me a room, and it's cluttered with crap. It's cluttered with old toys and junk games and televisions and doodads and this and that, and religious fetish items and voodoo items like the Christian cross, which is a voodoo fetish of torture. And, you know, and it's filled with all this regalia. The room is filled and cluttered with all this regalia, all this religious crap and all this technological crap. And I just look at you and I throw up my hands and I say, sorry, pal, but I can't install anything in that room, so you have to make the room for this installation. Do you understand? And that is why I presented these talks, as inadequate as they are and as brief as they are. My intention in the 3 talks of the Great Deception has been to show you pretty much that everything that you have ever learned about the supernatural is wrong. That's my intention. And as I say at the beginning of the Great Deception text, my commitment to you now is to hand over the tools that enable you to recognize and handle the power of the supernatural, and to show you the MO of the World Mother as she accomplishes her correction by hacking into the first attention of the human species. You don't even know what that means now, do you? Do you know what that means? What does that mean? What does that suggest to you? The mind of the planet itself, her mind, her aeonic super intelligence, has hacked into your mind. And unless you are a Gnostic and a Telestis trained in investigating matters of the supernatural, you can neither know how she did it, nor can you know what she intends to do now that she has access. Well, that is what I am here to tell you, and I am here to teach you. I'm not just here to tell you that, because I'm counting on the fact that you don't just really want to know. I'm here to teach you, counting on the possibility that you really mean to learn. So I ask you today, on this day, which is a sacred day for me, I ask you, how deep is your love? How deep is your love for your own body, for the miracle of being alive? How deep is your love for the planet that gives you life and gives you the setting for life and gives you the meaning of life? You know, I've said in a jocular fashion, I can be jocular, I'm going to meet my commitment to you, and along the way, I might dally around and take out Christianity and Buddhism just for the fun of it. Well, that's pretty much where it's at from my viewpoint. From your viewpoint, it's a serious matter to get Christianity and Buddhism out of your mind, out of your head, and out of your life entirely. Now I know, believe me, I know that it could be said that I'm asking a lot. But let me tell you, this is the only route to sanity. This is the only route to the ultimate sanity of the species. And it's a steep route, my friends. And I'm asking you to let go of a lot. I'm asking you to let go of pretty much everything you've ever been taught about the supernatural. Taught or told. Not taught anything, really. You've never been taught anything about the supernatural. I now begin to teach you about the supernatural. You've been told things. And you've believed things. And I'm asking you to blow it all out of you-know-what. And clear the room for this installation. This is awesomely beautiful. This is an awesomely beautiful event that happens in your life when you see your life in her story. But it only happens in that way and no other way. You know, as far as taking out Christians goes, I just want to throw in this little comment. The game is over for Christians, you know. They just don't know it yet. The game is over, and I intend to make that diamond clear in the immediate future. But the game is over for Christians, but they're still repeating a lot of pathetic cliches over and over again. These pathetic emotional cliches that come out of the Christians. And one of them is, oh, since I gave my life to the Lord, now I understand this. Now I understand the battle between good and evil. Since I gave my life to the Lord, I pray every day. And Christ Jesus is there to console me, and the Lord is there to advise me. So they're talking about these imaginary beings in their imagination, which are no better than an 8-foot purple rabbit named Ralph or whatever it is. Jesus is the imaginary friend of the human species who has betrayed it at every single moment since it was created. But nevertheless, you hear them saying this. They are pathetic. They are broken. Some of them are broken beyond repair. I would respond to a Christian who says to me, well, I've given my life to the Lord, and now everything's cool. What about you, John Lash? Are you ready to give your life to the Lord, to Christ Jesus and the Heavenly Father? Well, hold on a minute. I seem to remember being asked that question when I was about 6 years old, and I didn't respond to it too well, but I didn't know how to answer back because I didn't have the monumental arrogance that I have today. But now I can answer back. Arrogance means, by the way, the capacity to answer back. And I would answer back in this way. Well, the central figure of my religion, if you want to call it that, is the planet itself, whom I perceive as a divine mother and a divine presence. And I can't give my life to her, because it's already hers in the first place. So there you go. Simple, ain't it? I'm just a character in the dream of the earth. But I'm a dangerous character, and I like being that way. You can decide what kind of character you want to be in her dreaming. You want to be a peacemaker character? Fine. There's probably room for that in the script somewhere. It's a big script. But I belong to the den of wolves. I script myself as a dangerous character. The Calico Wolves have the scent of humanity in their nostrils. They have the scent of the fur of their kind. They do not hunt and kill their own kind. But the scent of those human animals who have lost the sense of humanity is different. And they are prey to the calico wolves. Ah, but I digress. So let me return in the remaining half hour of this talk to a couple of the main points in the third installment of The Great Deception. And finally, as usual, following the custom of the belated muse, to get to the fucking point, which is love and the supernatural. What I have attempted to do in the written text, The Great Deception Part 3, for the major part of the text, as you see, down to the last page or so, is to present a reprise of the subject, or the subjects considered, the themes, questions, and subjects considered in the previous two essays. And then, and in that respect, to make a summary and overview. So there are just two points. As I said before, if this was a 6-week, 3 times a week college course, we could just drive and jam on this and have a hell of a good time on the questions and objections that are raised. I love objections. I would like somebody to bring a stronger and more honest and authentic objection to my own teaching than I myself bring. That would be a fucking relief for a change. Okay? Because I am my most severe critic, and I suffer from that, I can tell you. But in an audience auditorium situation, we would wrap all these things out. We would jam. And certainly one of the questions that would come up is, well, wait a minute, John. You're dismissing demons which have been represented in religious teachings through all the ages as psychoid fictions that arise in a reflex process in the human psyche. That's exactly what I'm doing. That's exactly what I'm saying. That's all they are. So forget about it. There are no demons. There are no demons in the supernatural world. If you go into the Nahual of the Wisdom Goddess and you pass the fractal lattice of the serpentine dress veils of the Aztec protection mother goddess into the undulant folds of her knickers, there ain't no demons in those knickers, okay? Understand? Clear? So, what's the difference, John, between the Dakinis of which you speak with such praise and such enthusiasm and such affection and respect? What's the difference between the Gaian Dakinis, Shodashi, Idris, Bodhima, Kurukula? What is the difference between these psychic entities and the demons that you are now sweeping out of the house? You know? Well, the difference is very, very big. The difference is big, and it's right in your face. You know what's in your face? Go outside. Stick your head out the window. Go out and stand out in the field. What's in your face? It's the atmosphere. It's not only in your face, it's on your face. The atmosphere is on your face. You wear the atmosphere of the earth on your face. You wear it on your body as a garment. Okay? And the Gaian Dakinis, I have said before, are fractures in the nitrogen zone of the atmosphere. That is the precise technical telestic definition. They are zones of excitation, fracture zones in the nitrogen component of the atmosphere, and the atmosphere is 80% nitrogen. What do you think happens in that nitrogen in the atmosphere that's sitting in the atmosphere of the Earth, that's sitting in the 7 mile altitude of the troposphere where people live? What do you think is sitting there for? It's doing nothing? There's no activity in it? You think that there is no activity in the nitrogen zone of the atmosphere of the Earth? Well, why shouldn't there be? There's plenty of activity in the oxygen zone. There's all the airborne creatures. There's the saliva coming out of my mouth right now. There's the breath of your nostrils going out of your body and into your body. You've got part of the atmosphere in your lungs right now. All the aerobic creatures live in the atmosphere. The atmosphere is throbbing with life. You think that the nitrogen zone isn't? Huh? You see, this is something that you can only know in the way that I know it. But the way that I know it is not my personal thing. It's a method. Okay? It's a method. What is unique is not the man, but it's the method that the man uses. Okay? That's how I know these things, and not just me. You can believe that. Not just me. So, that's the answer to the objection that would be raised. Tom, why do you give such a special status to these Gaian Dakinis when, you know, you're dismissing all these other entities as psychoid indigestion morsels that are being vomited up by the human animal? Well, there's your answer. Everything is material. I will get to the subject of love in 5 minutes. Can you hang on that long? In those remaining 5 minutes, I would like to say this. I don't have a beef against Christians. I was brought up with Christians. And I think that Christians are kind of caught in the middle. You know, I've said this before. During the GNE, I gave a talk in which I used that song. It used to be a favorite song of Jan Kerouac. I'll never forget her hearing this song on the radio in the kitchen of a house on Delgado in Santa Fe one morning when we were drinking French Market coffee. And this song came on the radio and Jan broke into dance. Jan was a great dancer. She loved to dance. Clowns on the left of me, jokers on the right, stuck in the middle with you. She loved that song. That's the position of Christians. They're caught in the middle, you know. I mean, they're not anywhere as hideous as Jews in their religious ideology, or anywhere as hideous as Muslims in their religious ideology. There's a certain live and let live factor in Christianity, even though, granted, as I pointed out in Not in His Image, the salvationist ideology of Christianity has been murderous. So Christianity is also an instrument of the Jewish Zadokite virus. Granted. But Christians as people are, they're caught in the middle, you know? Nevertheless, I have to say I have absolutely no fucking compassion for them anymore. They are pathetic dupes, and they are going to go down very hard if they don't snap out of it soon. So I call upon you as my allies out there, you who follow the supreme sense of what I talk about, I call upon you to share this responsibility with me. Anytime I would have an occasion to stand before a Christian, I would just say this to them. The hallmark of terminal capture in the Great Deception is the absolute conviction of knowing how it works. And if you have to, just write it down on a piece of paper for them in that exact syntax and just hand it to them and say, my fellow Christian brother or sister, this is the best that I can do for you. You snap out of it or you're due for a mercy killing that you would that you could never see coming. So that's my final word on Christians and the Christian faith that still survives pathetically and absurdly on this planet. So I guess the moment has come to talk about love. Bear in mind that you are listening to the ravings of a man crazed by grief. So give me a little slack. Also bear in mind that I sometimes think of that line from the Jewish comedian, writer-director Woody Allen. No, it wasn't Woody Allen, was it? It was one of the Marx brothers. They were probably Jews, too. They were called Marx, right? I wouldn't belong to any club that would accept me as a member, right? You know, there is such a thing as Jewish comedy. I'm not against it as long as it's not directed toward the white race or any other race. So, yeah, there you go. Well, I would say this to all you Jews out there. Well, you can't belong to the club of the white race, so don't worry about it. Why am I bringing up this bizarre and not necessarily pleasant little anecdote, this little line? Because I put myself in that category regarding exposition of love. You know, I don't want to be in the same club with people who talk about love. And that's one of the biggest factors that has impeded me, or you could say, or what's the word I'm looking for, contributes to my reticence about talking about love. But I'm in the depths of grief right now. Well, I've been in grief a lot in my life, but I'm in the depths of a particular event of grief. And it's a funny thing, you know, I have to tell you, that there's something about grief and love, that they come together in some way. They cross each other in some way, some powerful nexus. Love and grief come together in a crossing point of human fate. I'm sure of that. So, what can I say about love right here, right now, on this winter day? There's a fire in the Finnish stove in the studio attic. You can hear it crackling at times, I think. I look out the window at the flatlands of Flanders, Western Belgium, Flanderen. Flanderen simply means the flatlands. It's four below. Fields are frozen. There are fat black crows scrabbling around in the furrows. I don't know what they're looking for. Sky is perfectly clear today. Even though Brussels Airport is no more than half an hour away, there's not one single chemtrail, not one single trace of pollution over this house. The sky is bird's egg blue. And here I am in this attic, all by my little lonesome, with no cats, just me. So put your mind into my mind and cast your mind back to a few years ago, say August of 2008. Do you remember something called the Terma of Gaia Awakening? I mean, suppose you were sitting in a cafe somewhere and an interesting person was sitting beside you at the next table and you're kind of like checking each other out. And at a certain moment, they kind of leaned over to you and they said, "Hi, how are you doing today?" "Oh, not bad." And they looked at you and they said, "Did you ever hear of the term of Gaia Awakening?" What would you say? In the term of Gaia Awakening, there are only three components. And the first component is itself an array of three components. These are the instructions of the Diamond Sky Dakinis. And the second instruction in the Dharma of Gaia Awakening goes like this. Love and the supernatural operate on the same frequencies. Now, you might recall, if you're one of those people who's listened to me consistently for a while, that I have remarked that the three instructions of the Dharma of Gaia Awakening are deceptively simple. They are disarmingly simple, which is a better word, because there's no deception in them at all. So I misspoke there. They are disarmingly simple. They are intended to disarm you immediately at a profound emotional level. It is almost impossible to comment or elaborate on these instructions. First of all, when you hear the instruction, love and the supernatural operate on the same frequencies, you might notice, you might detect that there is no tendency to question it or elaborate it or twist it around and look at it from one direction or another. Or if there is, you lose it immediately. But if you hold it in your mind, if you just receive the instruction of the Diamond Sky Dakinis of the Dharma of Gaia Awakening, then it floats in your mind like a weightless jewel. And you just look at this jewel. This jewel of non-elaborated thought. It is so simple. It is your realization of your life in the moment before you realize it. That's where this instruction floats. In the realization of what your life is in the moment, in the instant before you realize it. There it floats. So I wouldn't bring up this instructions. Do you ever hear me expounding on the Dharma of Gaia Awakening? Me, even me, I do not expound on that. But I make an allusion here. Because, obviously, it refers to love. And it refers to love and the supernatural. Love and the supernatural is a phrase in the term of Gaia Awakening. And what's the point? The point is that you are in the impact of both of them at the same time, and they operate on the same frequencies. I have done the best I can, considering the handicaps and considering the limitations of time and considering the conditions of the recorded voice transmitted on an archontic medium. I have done my best to get across to you a number of points in the three talks on the Great Deception. As a Gnostic scholar, I correct erroneous concepts. So, I have attempted, or I have challenged you, let's put it this way, I challenge you to clear all that garbage about the supernatural that you've been told. out of your mind and just leave an empty space. Don't worry what's coming in next. You can't reckon on what's coming in next if you make the room for it. And as you do that, just consider this above everything else. What I am teaching you, I intend for you to make your own. And I am teaching you that you live at every instance of your life, asleep or awake, in the pure impact of the supernatural. And contained within that impact, operating on the same frequencies, is the power of what you would like to call love. Now, I've said, but I haven't really written it down, or maybe I did write it down. I have said, though, that there are some things in planetary tantra and kala tantra, there are some teachings, if you will, some aphorisms, some, what's the word? Adages. I like that word. There are some adages in planetary tantra and kala tantra that can be written down, but generally we like to keep them oral. We like to just throw them around among ourselves and not write them down because it's fun to say them. For instance, it's fun to say that in Kali Yuga, enlightenment is just a game of pretenses. And whoever has the most pretenses wins the game. It's really fun to say this. It's a provocative thing to say. And that is one of the spoken adages of Kala Tantra. Well, one of the spoken adages of planetary tantra, you may recall, is this. Love is a force of discovery. Out of the cosmos, out of the unknown, out of the Nahual, forces are continually acting on the human animal. And among those forces, there is one that is supreme, really. It is supreme in its poignancy. It is supreme in the way that it carries the complementary modalities of pleasure and pain. It is a current within the overall field of impact of the supernatural upon you, and that is love. It comes to you from the universe. It is coming from the source of the universe and nowhere else. And it comes to you externally and finds its place in you. It finds its niche in you, or it does not. It does not find its niche. Love does not find its home in every human animal. I assure you of that. And I'm beginning to wonder more and more how many people can actually take it, what it really is, and handle it with humility, sobriety, and delight. I really wonder now. Love is not an emotion. Sorry to disappoint you if you were thinking along those lines. Love is not an emotion. It is a force that takes on emotional charge. It takes on emotional color in itself, being, let's say, transparent and without color. So how would you now out there listening to my words. How would you like to understand this? How would you like me to offer some understanding of what I mean when I say love is a force of discovery? Well, let me use a concrete example. You know, Socrates was credited by Aristotle with two achievements. One was the creation of irony, if you can consider that an achievement. And the other was the introduction of the inductive method in reasoning about moral questions. An induction means that you simply argue from individual to general cases. So the best I can do for you, following the old Socratic chestnut as it rolls down the road like a rolling stone that gathers no moss, the best I can do for you right now is give you an individual example, and then you can infer the general or universal case. Okay? Once upon a time, there was a man living in a foreign country, that is to say, not the country where he was born. And one day he drove in his car to a little town in the mountains of that country, and he met a woman from Denmark. And she took him for a walk up the streets of the town. And they went into this house, which was empty at the time, and entered the back garden of the house. And the Danish woman showed this man that there were two little cats in the garden. Two little cats. Kind of a tiger cat, bigger, and a little black cat. And they were probably 6 or 8 weeks old. Their eyes were all pussy and they were shivering. And there they sat in the corner of this garden, abandoned. And so the man took these cats home with him and they became his companions. And one of these cats, the little black cat, became quite a special companion to him. And anyone telling this story would pretty much use the same language to describe what happened, I think. They would say, well, great love grew up between this man and this cat. And the way that it would usually be expressed, I believe, is to say that, hey, the man who found this cat came to love her. Came to love her in a special way. But if you wish to consider that love is a force of discovery, then I submit this to you. That he loved her. Even before he ever set eyes on her. You know, some people think that the greatest words that one human animal can say to each other is, you know, oh, I love you. And those are fine words, and when they're authentic and honest, they are sublime words. You don't have to say them a lot. You say them to one time, to one person in your lifetime, and it's spectacular. But I maintain that there is something that can be said in love that is even better, that goes more to the heart and mystery of what love is. And I would say, I loved you before I ever set eyes on you. If you could say that to someone and really know what you were saying, then you would be expressing the realization that love is a force of discovery. Sure, the way the story would ordinarily be told, oh, that man living in a foreign country found that cat and he came to love that cat. That's the conventional explanation. But the mystical explanation is that love is the force of discovery that brought him to the cat and the cat to him. You know, it might not sound like such a big deal. I mean, it's just a distinction, you know. It's another one of those fucking Gnostic nuances, right? And it might not sound like such a big deal, but it is a very big deal. Everything that you have ever loved was brought to you by the power of love, which is the root power of all that exists. And everything that you've ever loved, be it a book, be it a tree that you sat under as a kid, be it a toy sailboat that you had or a real sailboat that you sailed in or a rowboat, be it a beach that you loved, be it a person, be it a dog, be it a cat, be it a horse, be it a snake, be it a pet tarantula, everything that you could ever come to love was brought to you by the force of love operating out of the supernatural on the same frequencies as the supernatural. And when you enter into the love of a place, or a person, or an animal, and there's something really important about the love for non-human animals that needs to be said soon in the process of this super learning event, that would be Nikita's instruction. You know, sometimes grief comes with loss or death, you know, it can come in many ways. But, well, I'll have to tell you, guaranteed, it will come with loss or death. Grief will come. And in that particular instance of grief, on that particular occasion of loss, you will have instruction, too. With death, the death of someone you love, human or not human, there comes instruction from the supernatural. And that instruction constructs itself in you. And thereafter, that is an indelible and inseparable part of your humanity. And it's only love that is working through death in that way. Death has no meaning without love. Death is meaningless without love. That perhaps is the terror of death, and why it appears to be cool and cold and relentless to some people. Because to experience death without love would be indeed cold, empty, and meaningless. So this force of discovery that comes from out of the depths of the cosmos is love, operating on the same frequencies as the supernatural. Now remember the definition of the supernatural coming through these three talks and texts on the Great Deception. Supernatural is the foundation and matrix of the natural. Remember the analogy of the fountain. You see a fountain contained by a wall, a circular wall. There's the pool of the fountain, and then there is the upright part of the fountain with water erupting from the top. All the phenomena of nature are like the water erupting from the fountain. But the supernatural is the wellspring of that fountain. So in completing what I can say to you about love in whatever way I can say it, you can take it for what it is or not. It would not be complete if I didn't add a kind of warning to you. Yeah, I'll say it's a warning. It's a challenge. This is a challenge. The challenge of love. Are you ready? Challenge of love is simple. And every human being faces it every day. The force of love working upon the human animal out of the supernatural is constant. It's like a wind. It's like a wind that comes to you and blows over you. Be poised to learn about the impact of the supernatural now. Discard everything else you've been told about it. And free yourself to learn what the impact of the supernatural really is. And as you do that, prepare yourself to understand that it comes from outside you. And love comes from outside you. It comes externally and finds its niche in you, and then it's yours, and then it's internal. But it's only internal because you own it and receive it. And those who don't have no love in them, and there are many, they are legion. But what is the challenge? Quite simply, it's this. That the flow and manifestation of love and its impact operates externally, except in one instance, except in one sole singular instance. That man's love for his cat Nikita happened. And Nikita's love for him happened because the force of discovery of love acting externally in the universe brought them together. Love brought the man and the cat together. Do you see what I'm getting at? Love brought you to the one you love. And brought that one to you. And it's an external process. And everything is material. But there is one instance when the love has to come from you. First. That is the operative word. First. It can't be installed in you. Even the power of love flooding through the universe cannot install in you this one
act of love. That is the challenge. It has to come from you first. And what is that act? It's love for the planet. It's love for the world. Mother herself. It's love for the Aeon Sophia as the planet on which you live, the source of your life. It is the love for the source of your life that has to come from you internally. That is the sole exception. The universe itself, which is founded on love, provides every other opportunity. But this opportunity stands unique. And it must, by her own determination, be this way. I say it is by her own determination. Why? Because even she cannot compel you to love her. Even though she is an instrument of cosmic love that has given birth to this experiment and the human species, and even given birth to what troubles the experiment by an anomaly. But whoever said that love couldn't make mistakes? And haven't you made mistakes in love? So the Aeonic Mother, whom you see looking out of your eyes, the goddess you see, not the invisible god that you can't see, the goddess that you behold, cannot compel you to love her. That is the voluntary first and unique act of love of every human animal. So I warn you, there is a wonderful truth about love to be learned and to be owned. But even the power of love flooding the universe as a force of discovery cannot bring you to the love of the Earth, the planetary animal mother. Only you can bring yourself to that love. Or not. That is the difference. That is the challenge. That is the unique opportunity. And if you want to learn about the supernatural, if you want to undergo this installation of which I speak, and if you want to become one of those human animals, dangerous and delightful creatures that handles the power of the supernatural, then you must love the source of it, the immediate source of it, or else you will never comprehend it, and you will never handle it, and it will never, ever be given to you to do so. So that's my warning, and that's my concluding word in this spoken commentary that goes along with the Great Deception. Part 3, among the things that you take away and the things that you consider from what I said, you might want to reflect on an obvious but little known fact of human existence. And that is the simple fact that most people, most human animals, do love their lives. They love their own lives. And yeah, of course, you know, that's perfectly natural. You love your own life, of course. I mean, if you don't, you're going to be a sad and sick creature. But do you, I ask you in closing, do you love your own life to the exclusion of loving the source of your life? That's the question that I leave with you at the conclusion of this talk. And that's just about all I have to say, or all I can say on the subject of love, right here, right now.